So I'm going to talk about R, C++, and integrating those two languages together. And in order to do that, I'm also going to introduce R. I assume that not everyone in the audience is familiar with R, or are there some R users among us today? None. That's completely fine, so that's what we are going to start with. Then we are going to connect R to C++. We are going to show how to set it all up, how to exchange data, and what are the further resources when we can find out more. But before I do that, I would like, as a way of introduction, to talk about my first computer. So my first computer was an 8-bit Atari. And when you booted it up, it shone a screen like this. It said ready. You had a beautiful blue foreground. And you could also see that there was a black border around it. Now, historically, there was a reason for this border. Before my Atari, which is a 65XC model, there was an earlier Atari called Atari VCS. It had an interesting feature that its display didn't have a frame buffer. What it meant is that you had to create your graphics one scanline at a time and synchronize with the electron beam. So the only time when it wasn't plotting horizontal blank and vertical blank were the times where you were actually allowed not to care about rendering and maybe you could do some computation. Counting cycles was really important at that time. Well, my Atari was way more fancy, so one of the first things we did was to take the color of the foreground that was living in the memory location 710, and then poke that same color into memory location 712, and now we had a huge screen. You could make this code shorter, but that was still BASIC. There was an interesting thing in BASIC on Atari is that you could embed machine code. Well, before we go to machine code, we can talk about higher level of abstraction. There was a user-friendly higher level of abstraction called assembly language. And on 6502, I think the claim is it really was user-friendly. Notice that the code is even shorter than BASIC code. We were loading the contents of the memory address into the accumulator, and then we were storing the accumulator into memory address 712. That's it. It's simple, it's beautiful, it's easy, right? And if you wanted to call this as a subroutine, you just had to pull the accumulator to have the argument count, and you had to return from the subroutine. Now, every single of those assembly instructions had an opcode, an operation code on 6502 that you can then use it to encode this as numbers. When you did that, you store all of this in a data statement, you poked all of those numbers into memory location, you could then call the subroutine at this memory location, voila. So, was it worth it? In many ways, yeah. If you can compare the speed of the code on the top of the screen and the speed of the code in the middle, I even divided the timings for you, you can see that the difference is 5/3. The unit of measurement is actually GFIS, which is 1/60 of a second. So the original BASIC code was around 66.6% slower. So the takeaway from all of this is that sometimes it pays off to alternate hard and soft interfaces to have different parts of your code base with different performance characteristics done somewhat differently, and at the same time, it would be nice if you could exchange data from one part of your code base to another and have it just work, which is called foreign function interface. Now, PC compatibles came along. They kind of became popular. I think many people have them. Not that many people have Atari. So it's probably all different now. Or is it? Well, let's talk about R. R is awesome. That's the disclaimer number zero here. It's a great programming language. There are many reasons which I think that explain why it's awesome. Environment statistical computing and graphics, similar to S. So first thing of all, S was developed at the Bell Labs. Plenty of pretty nice languages have been developed by Bell Labs. Wide variety of statistical and graphical techniques. Vehicle of choice for research in statistical methodology. ease of well-designed publication quality plots, free software cross-platform. What do we mean by wide variety of statistical and graphical techniques? What we mean by this is that there is over 7,000 packages, which is another term for libraries, that you can download, install, and use just like that. There is a central repository called CRAN, the Comprehensive R Archive Network. It's all maintained. It's categorized. You can see that the classes span everything from Bayesian statistics through bioinformatics, web design, machine learning. And if you just look at machine learning, there is a package called Caret, which takes most of those machine learning algorithms and supports seamless model selection, model validation across many of them. So it's not just a point that there is a 7,000 packages. The point is that they are integrated, they work well together, and they are updated in sync. And you don't have a problem with clashing dependencies between those 7,000 packages. What do we mean by vehicle of research for statistical methodology? Well, many people like Friedman Hasty, Simon and Tipchirani lead research in statistics. They invent tools like elastic nets, lasso. Usually when those people publish a paper, at the same time they will publish an R package, and then we publish a documentation for that package. So leading statistical researchers not only use R in their research, they publish packages that you can use to be able to use their techniques straight away. Those same people also happen to write books. There are online courses, so if you would like to learn anything about, say, statistical machine learning, you will often find yourself using R, just because that's what plenty of literature uses. There is a great package called ggplot2 for visualization. There is also a pretty nice IDE, and I think it is worth mentioning in this conference. It is an open source C++ application. It's on GitHub. It's made with Qt. And this is how it looks when you start it up. You have a syntax highlighted editor. You have a workspace with the variables. You have an interactive console or the red eval print loop. And you have figures that you can use. So suppose you would like to get there. Suppose you have a fresh installation. You have nothing on your computer. You would just like to show this figure. You basically need three lines of code. You need to install package. In this case, it's ggplot2. You need to load the library after it's installed, and then you just call the command. So this is an example. This is a fresh installation. I just tried to type the command, and as you can see, I don't have the library, I don't have the package, so it doesn't work. Well, I type install packages ggplot2 and I press enter. Bunch of stuff pops up on the screen, then I load the library, and then I have a plot. So that's the kind of workflow you have for all of those 7,000 packages or libraries. You just type install, you press enter, you just type library, you press enter, and you just use it. It should just work. Our users mostly don't know what a build toolchain is. They don't know what a makefile is. They don't care about configure versus CMake versus Ninja. They just want things to work. You can also, of course, it's 2015, so you can put everything on a website and this can be interacted with. I guess that's not unusual today. You can, of course, also create documents with Markdown, which allow you to embed your R code, generate results of that R code, embed plots from that R code. You can also do this if you like. Instead of HTML5, you can use PDF. Also, you can generate slides all from the same input. I would also like to point out that you can use mathematics in LaTeX. One of the supported outputs is Microsoft Word. It's not gonna just embed figures, it's going to create an environment with Microsoft Equation Editor, and you can edit and adjust your formulas in Microsoft Equation Editor. Because then, it should just work. And I have to say that the credit here is deserved by the wonderful open source Haskell application called PanDoc by John McFarlane. Thank you. Now, the popularity of R is growing. It is far beyond just statistics now. If you look at the books on Amazon, this is just one of the results page, and it's everywhere from social sciences to time series to bioinformatics. One of the books which I would like to point out is kind of relevant here is a book by Dirk, similar to R and C++ integration with Rcpp. There are plenty more examples he has shown in that book. I'm just going to have a mere showcase. So, as you can see, I do like R, and I think it's wonderful, and it has a lot of great features, and it's amazing. But we are programmers here, so we know that there is no perfect. There are only trade-offs. So here's one of the trade-offs. Suppose you would like to sum a bunch of numbers. It's not an uncommon task. What you're gonna do in R is to write a function, you're gonna take numbers as an input, you're gonna initialize your result counter to zero, you're gonna iterate through each number in your collection of numbers, update the result by the number plus the result, and store it and return it. So it's very reasonable, right? Well, let's try this with 10 billion numbers. Let's time this four-hour function called sum loop, which uses loop in order to perform summation, and let's compare this to the built-in function in R, which actually calls C API implementation. Yes, we have numbers going from 1 to 2 to 3 up to a million. It takes 4 seconds for our sum loop. How much time do you think it's going to take for sum? How much faster? So it actually takes 0.01 seconds. The difference is 400 times, more or less. So that's one of the trade-offs. Why? Can we do something about it? Well, R is basically executing its code as a virtual machine in a way. Virtual machines have bytecode. We can precompile the bytecode. This is what we are going to do here. And we can also stare at the disassembled bytecode, which sometimes is illuminating. If you compare the results, we have now a new result. It's no longer 400 times slower. Now it's only 40 times slower. Yeah, 10x speed up. Let's only talk about the 10x and forget about everything else. Yeah. So what is happening here? If you see the disassemble, maybe I can go back to the original R code, there's actually a relation between these two. When I was adding those numbers, you see, I had to load the value in result, I had to load the value in number, I had to add these two together, and I had to store the updated value in result again. So I was getting variable, I was getting variable, I was adding variable, and I was setting variable. And it is indeed what I was doing. Notice here that in the disassembled bytecode we have getVar, we have getVar, we have add, and we have setVar. So it's fairly what would you expect. Problem is, we also do some popping. Well, the popping comes from the way R for loop works. It's actually iterating over an actual collection of numbers, so it's an object containing numbers, it's not any lazy generator, and it just literally pops every single of those 10 million numbers, one number at a time. So, yeah, we can make it faster with the bytecode, but the bytecode is still a virtual instruction set architecture, and it's still going to operate on one number at a time. And it's still gonna have to be translated one number at a time to a physical instruction set architecture, which for Microsoft is x86. So Rcpp, we can make it faster. Now it's in the same ballpark as the built-in. I'm going to talk much more about it. So let's just explain why is it faster. There's a very nice tool I would like to show. Maybe some of you already know this tool. It's called GCC Explorer. It allows you, by Matt Godbold, who deserves all the credit. What it allows you to do is to paste your C++ code here on the left. What it's gonna show on the right is the generated assembly output, and notice there are colors. Colors are nice. In this case, those colors have meaning. They actually highlight the line of the code in assembly that corresponds to the line in C++. That's pretty handy in understanding what your C++ code does too. So you notice that it's actually fairly similar. We have some addition. We also have addition because we have a loop counter now. We are not popping objects from any collection. We are actually iterating as it's meant to be. And we are also storing the results. So move in assembly in x86 has an overloaded meaning. It can be used to load, it can be used to store. But other than that, it's fairly what you would expect. Difference being that this is an x86 instruction set architecture. That's actually what your machine understands. So that's basically, there's a lot of debate about faster, slower, interpreted versus compiled, but to me this really explains why compiled languages are usually faster. They take this tiny little implementation detail called physical machine into account. We can look at the assembly code generated from our Rcpp. What's interesting about it is that it's actually the exact same assembly code. No extra boilerplate, so of course it's gonna be in the same ballpark. Is it faster? Yeah. We can now use our sum. Sum is just going to be implemented using loop. We can actually go a bit further. We can use that thing called OpenMP. We have multiple cores on our CPU. And now we are not only outperforming the original built-in sum, it's already outperformed in just Rcpp, it's twice as fast here, but it becomes twice as fast still again if you use parallelization. Well, that is one of the selling points of Rcpp, is that it gives you access to C++. And what does C++ give you the access to? There is a guy, I think he needs no introduction, Ulrich Drepper. If you ever use GCC, then you probably are familiar with him. He had this nice talk about utilizing the other 80% of your system's performance. And sure, multicore is important. We all read the free lunch is over. We also know about the memory wall, we know about the power wall and what frequency scaling does to the power and energy requirements of your core. But there is something more about this. Each and every core has plenty of execution units. Those execution units operate on 256 bits. Your one double number has 64 bits. What it means, you can operate on 4 packed numbers at a time. If you don't, you are just leaving the 80% of your CPU core unutilized. So this is the way I would like to think about C++ and Rcpp. It doesn't always make your code automatically faster by magic, but it enables you to utilize the remaining 80% of performance. And when it matters, it's quite handy to have. So how do we use Rcpp? How do we integrate R with C++? Historically, it was started with a library called Quantlib. It's a finance library. It was done quite a long time ago, and many people actually wanted to use it just for convenience. There were lots of algorithms and pricing engines in Quantlib, and R users wanted to just have the access to them. That started the R Quantlib project. That was already in 2006. The project kinda stalled for a while, so it was revived. And today, mainly with contributions driven by Dirk and Roman, we have Rcpp, which enables to access all of the C++, not just Quantlib library from R. It is fairly popular. It was used by 400 R packages. That was then. This is now. It's growing closer to 500 today. And I think there is a parallel in C++ development that explains this. You have probably noticed that something happened around 2011, something happened around 2014. The language got a bit different, right? So this is how we used code before C++ 11. Can anyone tell me immediately what this code does? I'm standing down. So, oh well, it actually produces a bunch of numbers and it sums them up. That's it. Well, with C++, this is how it looks. It produces a bunch of numbers and it literally sums them up. I would say it's declarative because you can just read the code of left to right, top to bottom, and it's pretty much exactly doing what it is expected to do. There is a nice expression by Herb Sutter, this is not your father's C++. And I think that explains the popularity of C++ 11 and 14. Now, how did we exchange data and how did we interoperate with R before Rcpp? What you had was your original implementation. Fibonacci is basically a numeric hello world, so let's look at Fibonacci. And you were able to keep it. But then you had to write a wrapper it was taking something called S expression, it was returning something called S expression, and oh, remember, R is dynamically typed garbage collected language. It would be a shame if the data that you are trying to pass from R was garbage collected while your C++ code was executing. So what you had to do is to tell the garbage collector to please hold on to this. Let's protect it from collection. It then did a boatload of casts, because dynamically typed language, sometimes that means unityped language, so you have to give the variables types. It did some more casts, because casts are fun. Then you were able to tell the garbage collector it doesn't have to hold to the input anymore, and then you were returning the result. After you did all this dance, you were able to call the library from R, except I cheated to my disadvantage. You actually had to still issue link, compile, and build commands, and then load the dynamically load library or the shared object into R before you were actually able to use this line. So how do you do this with Rcpp? So it is passed by reference, and R doesn't know about C++ or C code. So when we exchange data, it can literally garbage collect it without being aware that there are some other references leading to that object. Yes. Yeah. You mean here? Above the protect but. What happens before the protect but after the open curly? Well, that's nothing yet, actually. So we only pass the reference through an X expression. I'm going to talk a little bit about X expressions. And it's kind of like an address to that object in memory. But we don't adjust any reference count or do anything like that. We just literally pass the reference to something that may disappear. We'll address that perhaps later a little bit. Hold on to that. How do we do this in Rcpp? Well, that's how. We basically just keep the original code, and then we just add one more line on top of this. This actually has, syntax has been inspired by C++11 attributes, except we also want this to work with C++98 compilers, so what we added is a comment here. And that's it. We can now use this automatically from R. We don't have to add any boilerplate. It just works. So maybe there's a reason it's becoming popular now. Now, how does it work? How can you use it? Suppose you have a freshly installed R, RStudio, you have nothing else on your computer. We create a CPP file, and it contains exactly the same contents as before. I try to execute this. First thing that I'm going to see is kind of like I saw with ggplot2. There is no package called rcpp. Well, so I do the usual dance. As an R user, I'm used to install packages, so I install package. I try to execute this now. Notice I said fresh installation, so of course it doesn't have a C++ compiler. Well, there is an option. We can install those additional tools, including GCC. Let's do that. Let's run it. It just works. The same story is on Linux, so you can have a fresh installation, also have the exact same IDE. You try to run it, you notice that there is no package, you install package, you run it, it just works. So that's pretty much the story. Whether you use Windows, whether you use OS, whether you use Linux, we want this to be smooth for you, and if you don't know about build toolchains, you don't know about make files, you should be able to just press enter a few times and it should be able to figure out your platform. There are caveats here. So one of the caveats is that R language itself is a C application using C API. Rcpp is a C++ application, which means that if you would like to interoperate with this C++ application, one of the constraints that you are going to be facing is application binary interface compatibility. So that's one of the issues. You cannot basically share C++ code compiled with one compiler, with C++ code compiled in another compiler without doing some extra dance, if anything. So the easiest thing is to just use the same compile that was used to compile R. That's also what is fetched automatically for you. On POSIX systems, you actually will have some binary compatibility, so it may be easier than that, but I'm just saying the easiest story here. Although I did hear about someone from the mailing list just compiling R with MSVC. I don't know how far he got, but that might be another solution. So what are those S expressions I told you about? That's basically a type. It's an acronym stands for simple expression, inspired by Lisp, which is a pointer to a structure with a certain type def. And this structure is kind of like a variant. So if you have ever used the boost variant, if you would like to have an object that sometimes is an integer, sometimes is a character, you needed to have some kind of tagged union, a union with a tag which tells you what type the object currently is. So that's exactly what the SEXP is, and that's how the entire interchange of data between R. Can you hear me? Great. So that's how the exchange of data between R and native code is organized. And this is also what the protect and unprotect do. But with Rcpp, you can just use this automatically. So if you have a function Fibonacci, you can even use it as a text that you can store in a test variable on the R side. And if you would like, you could also try to interpret with SEXP. I think I'm just going to show this for reference to give an example what it takes and what is automatically generated. So suppose you would like to receive S expression from R, and then you would like to return some native type from C++ as a S expression. When you receive something from R, and you would like to be converted to a native code, you can use as. So if input variable n is an S expression coming from R, you can just say that I would like to interpret this as an integer. And now you have the access to the integer n. And now suppose you have done some work with this integer, produced another integer, and you would like it returned back to R. You can wrap it, and the name for doing that is also called wrap, which takes your native object and it converts it to an S expression that can be passed to the underlying global level R API interface. So those are basically two most important functions, receiving data from R, RcppS, passing data to R, RcpP wrap. After we have this, yes? Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. So the question is whether this is what is going to be compiled and whether this is what is going to be used from R. So the thing is, we are in R now, and we define the variable containing a C++ code, which is just a string variable, right? And then what we also define, that is just the implementation of the function. We also define the body of the wrapper. So if you recall, we had those two steps in this lower level interface when you had your original implementation of the native function, and you had the wrapper that had to take care of the data transfer to and from R. So the body of the wrapper is just Fibonacci body, which is using S and wrap, while the implementation function, just mean the implementation is included here, and that's the Fibonacci implementation. Does it answer the... Right. So now we obtain the Fibonacci function using inline package and function CXX function. The scope resolution operator is kind of similar here, and then we can call this from R. Now, if you look at the... Sure, why not?
Just so you don't have to hold it for...
No worries. Thank you very much. So we can look at what's generated if you enable the verbose output equals true. You will see that there is a familiar pattern here. So our code gets passed unmodified. But in addition, we also have the wrapper, and this is exactly when the body of the wrapper went. So remember, R API only understands S expressions, that's what it traffics in. So this is where our S expression in comes in, and this is when S expression comes out. And that's exactly the part that's generated automatically for you most of the time, but if you would like, you can have the control over this part as well. Now, most of the time you don't like to write that much, you don't even want to write the body of the wrapper, so you can go a bit further, you can go one step higher, and you can have the entire wrapper generated for you. This is done by one of the functions from Rcpp called CPP function. It also allows you to pass the source code as a text argument. It's going to be called Fibonacci source variable. We pass it here, we execute the CPP function, and then we obtain a callable object that we can call. So this is the difference between the Rcpp CPP function and the inline package, is that now you only had to pass the original source code. And this is still something you can do at runtime, you can even do it from the console, so you don't even need to have a separate .cpp source code file. And again, I can look at the generated output, it looks fairly much similar, except now we have a bit more generality. We also allowed a reentrant random number generation, which I'm going to talk about if I have time. And last but not least, this is what I use most of the time, and I think I would recommend everyone to use, is to have our original source code, store this in .cpp file, which you probably already do if you have an existing CPP code base, and the functions that you would like to export, you can just add attributes. These are common, so they will not disturb anything, they will not disturb the compilation of the pre-existing code base. You can then source that source code from RCPP using the source CPP function, giving it the file name as the argument, and that's going to make the function Fibonacci automatically available from R, going through pretty much the same process. And the wrapper again, fairly much the same thing. There is also an exception handling, but I would like to go through the data structures because exchanging data is often what we are interested in. The foundation of this is basically called R object. And two most interesting R objects are numeric vector and integer vector. So these kind of correspond, actually closely correspond, as we'll see in a moment, to std vector of double and std vector of int. And if you recall, previously when we were exchanged data with R, we had to do this manual protect unprotect call, and we had to do this to be paired with scope. So if the object was going out of scope, we wanted this to be unprotected. There is a solution for that kind of thing in R, C++. It's called RAII, and this is exactly what every single R object uses. So that gives you automatic resource management when the resource is a S expression. And because that's kind of similar to what smart pointers do in C++, I kind of like to think about this as a smart S expression, something that manages itself. Now, you can pass a bunch of integers from R, and you can use the RCPP integer vector for that. And when I said it's kind of similar to standard containers, it means you can use it as a standard container. For instance, you can include algorithm, and then you can call stdaccumulate, and then you can just pass the iterator to the first element of the vector and one pass the last element of the vector, and that is going to work with stdaccumulate. We are going to pass numbers from 1 to 5 in R, and this function call returns their sum, which is 15. So this is all relatively, I think, smooth, because it allows you to use the same syntax you are used to on the C++ side, and it allows you to use the same syntax you're used to on the R side. Now, there is one thing here. We generally expect the use case for is that the users are going to exchange lots of data with R, so they will be passing vectors, those vectors may be large, they will be passing matrices, and they will be passing this back and forth a lot of times. In order to accommodate that, the call semantics for this, it is not called by value. What is actually represented by RCPP integer vector is a lightweight proxy object. A name for this is also reference semantics. The flip side is that if you have a function, let's call this function tweak, because it's going to tweak element of that vector, and you're going to pass a vector v to that function, you can then modify it, let's say initial element, set it to 42. Those changes are going to refer to the exact same object as it was alive in R. So for instance here, on the R side, we have a vector with numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We can assert that this is the case, using stop if not. We can then call our function and notice that at this moment, the elements of the vector have been modified because we set the initial element to 42. Any questions? Yeah, yeah, so exactly. So that's the difference here, is that in order to accommodate the interchange of large data objects, the decision here was to use the reference semantics to basically avoid the pass-by value overhead. And that's exactly, as you mentioned, this is different from R, and sometimes that surprises users, so I'm going to show you a solution for that just in a moment. So that's essentially the difference, is that the changes propagate back to R because this is a proxy object, so it's referring to the exact same area of memory. We don't do any copy. Not by default. Of course, this holds for any RCPP vector. It also holds for numeric vector or floating point values. You can sort it in the C++ function, and then when you return from this to R, it's going to be sorted. And in this example, I showed that sometimes this is actually what you want, because sometimes you do want to have a function that does some work on some data, and you would like this work to persist. So for all of those use cases, this is actually desirable, but it's not always desirable. So what you can do is to perform a deep copy. And you can do this with function rcpp clone. This is exactly what is happening on line 7 here. So what we initially obtain is a proxy object rcpp numeric vector. It's in variable v in. We then create a local object called v, which contains a clone, a deep copy of the data in the original object. And now we can show the values before in C++. They're in the descending order. We call it std sort. Now they are in the ascending order. And then we return to R, but R means its own original object, so we only ever worked on a copy. So that's basically another tool. Sometimes you want to have copy or value semantics, sometimes you want to have reference semantics. Both are supported, but you need to remember which one. Yes? By default, 32-bit, for better or for worse. To my understanding, yes, because there is a type called __r__xlen, which is basically for representing lengths. It's a little bit like std size, except it's signed, so it's actually closer to std pointer div t. And that's the type that on at least the both LLP64 data model and LP64 will be 64-bit. But yes, and that's, and they are, I would only use doubles here because R itself doesn't support floats. Yes. Good question. So there are more homogeneous data structures. Some of the most important ones are numeric matrix, which is a matrix of floating, of double precision floating point numbers, logical vector, Boolean numbers, character vector, and row vector, if you just would like to exchange data with networking applications. There are also different data structures which allow you to store objects of different types. They are called heterogeneous because you can have one element which has type int, another element which has type double, another element which is a string. And you can kind of think of this being a generic vector, which is just an alias for a list. The closest equivalent in C++ would be something like std vector of boost any. So boost any is an object that changes its types depending on what you store into it. Values carry types is the phrases for this in dynamically typed languages. So this is also supported. And you can also name those elements. I think it's easier to just show an example here. Suppose you would like to create a numeric vector just as before. It's going to contain three double precision floating point numbers, 1.1, 2.2, and 3.3. What you could do is to call a factory function called create that's going to take those values together with names using the Rcpp named construct. The first one is going to be named alpha, then you're going to have beta, then you're going to have gamma. And then when you call this function from R, those names are going to propagate as well. So this is kind of convenient for idiomatic code because a lot of users of R are statisticians and they would like to have the results that often show you something like coefficient, standard error of the coefficient, p-value on the coefficient. So this is the feature that supports something like this. And you can also use this to receive named arguments from R. In this example, we are going to receive also two arguments of two different types. So suppose you are in R and you create a list, which is a heterogeneous container in R. First element is named year and it contains value 2015. Another element is called con and it contains text CppCon. And then you call a function called greet, which is in C++. You can then access the element with name year by using the usual bracket substitute operator and using rcpps. Remember, those types can be anything, they are dynamically typed source, so we do have to tell what this is supposed to be interpreted as. We can do then the exact same thing for the con. Notice that we interoperate with the standard libstd string type. There is no need to invent more string types, perhaps. And then what we can do is to show a greeting, which was the greeting CppCon 2015. So we can do a bit more. In R, user sometimes would like to define a function in R, call it square, because it squares two numbers together. What we can do is to also pass a R function, a CPP function, and have it executed on C++ side. The way it's accomplished is that you pass the name of that function as it exists in our environment. And then you pass the argument as you would pass it normally. So we are going to square number 2. Then, on the side of C++, construct an RCPP function object called f, and you pass the name of the function you would like to access from R to its constructor. You then have a function f made available for you. We can call this with the arguments, and it still supports dynamic typing, so you can extract the result as double, and then you can return it back to R. So that is sometimes convenient because when you want to integrate with existing codebase of R, not everything is necessarily performance sensitive. Sometimes you are just adjusting the data, you are doing data mangling or cleaning or selecting columns. In this case, it's convenient to be able to use R functions again from your C++. Of course, don't expect magic here. They are still R functions, so every single performance downside, of course, applies. There is also plenty of rich APIs that you can access, in particular the statistical distributions from R, but I think I'm going to show you how can you extend this, how can you use your own classes and your own types and have it all integrated as we have seen with std string or std vector. So as we have seen, the most important functions are s and wrap. If you would like to receive data from R and have it converted to your user-defined C++ type, then S is what you are going to use. If you would like to pass your user-defined C++ type and pass it back to R, we are going to wrap it. There are two ways of extending your codebase here. There is an intrusive extension and non-intrusive extension. Intrusive means that you're gonna have to modify your existing codebase, and at conversion, you can add implicit constructor that takes as expression, and you can add implicit conversion operator. Personally, I kind of prefer the non-intrusive way. It satisfies what is called an open-closed principle. What this means is that if you have existing C++ codebase, you would like to keep it closed for modification. You don't want to ever change a single line of code. but you would like to keep it open for extension, you would like to make it interoperable with R. So this is what is supported by the non-intrusive extension method, and that's called specialization, also because we accomplished this through template specialization. Here's how to do this. Let's focus primarily on this line at first. You have your own user-defined type called point. It's a struct, and contains two coordinates, coordinate x, coordinate y, they are both doubles. You can then make it possible to pass it back to R by implementing the template specialization for it. So normally that line of code would be something that you include from your existing code base. You can just use hash include, you do not modify anything in this line or anything in this code block. You have to say that there exists a way to wrap it, which takes your user-defined type, it takes it by const reference here, and it returns an as expression. At this point, you have declared the existence just by the mere fact of the template specialization declaration. So right now, we are already able to say rcpp export and be able to have a function wrapped that returns your user-defined type, exactly as if you were returning std string or std vector of double. Then, independently of that, you can implement the actual conversion routine. In this case, for example, what we can do is to pass it as a numeric vector. We are going to use the named facility just to illustrate with named coordinate x, named coordinate y, creating from the values under object p value x and value y. And then I can call this from R. Notice that function wrapped is going to take argument x, which is of type double, take argument y, which is of type double, it's going to instantiate another object point, it's going to use aggregate initialization to fill the values of the data members, and then we are going to return point to R. And indeed, this works as you would expect. When you call this, you obtain an object in R that has names x and names y. So I think this is very simple to use because you didn't have to change your existing code base and you can make it appear as something that is acting like a built-in type in R, which I think is convenient. You can also do it the other way around. So sometimes you would like to receive objects from R and have them converted to your user-defined types. So going the other way around means rcpp as. And suppose, just for the sake of illustration, we are going to work with also type point. We're just going to go the other way around. What we would like to do is to obtain a two-dimensional point as an input and then compute the squared norm of that point. So notice that it's a bit different because we are not exporting an object of type point to R. We are trying to receive an object convertible to point from R. And it goes analogously. We declare a function template specialization. It's going to be accepting any as expression from R containing coordinates. This is just one object. And then we are going to define a conversion. For example, we could do is to have a numeric vector which has our coordinates. It's going to have a first value of the coordinate, it's going to have another value, and then creates a point. So then what I can do is to pass one object from R. I can have object called coordinates, which contains a concatenation of value 1 and 2 together, so this is essentially a collection of two numbers as one object in R. I can show it, it looks like this, so it's 1 and 2. And then I call the squared norm, it accepts my point, it uses the conversion routine I have defined, and it returns the squared norm. So that's essentially the way that I think is the simpler. Use the S on one side, use the wrap on the other side, and remaining conversion is going to be performed automatically. There is also a solution for wider scope of applications. It's actually been inspired by Boost Python. Boost Python has a pretty nice tool called Boost Python Modules, which allows you to export entire classes, including the data members and their member functions, and then have them called as ordinary objects in Python. So there is an analogous feature in R. It's fittingly named Rcpp module. You can use it like this. You create point module. There's going to be a class point in C++ named point on the side of R, and then you can export the data members from C++ as fields in R, and you can also export another data member Y from C++ as another field in the corresponding R object. So if you have a wider, larger class, this is another tool that you can use, but most of the time, personally, I actually find that as and wrap are sufficient for my needs. Well, I mentioned Python, so one thing that I would like to show you is that we can use Boost Python as well. In particular, what we can do is to have a Python embedded in C++ code, and then we can call the C++ code from R, and then we can say, hello, CppCon from Python, and have it appear in R for RCPP. So if that's your boat, then feel free to do that as well. Now, sugar is another feature that is implemented. It allows you to have a syntactic sugar for commonly used vector white operations. For instance, sometimes you have a bunch of numbers in one vector X and in another vector Y, and you'd like to simply answer a question with just one boolean. Is it true that any element in X is less than element in Y? So in this case, we have one vector containing values 1 to 3. We have another vector containing values 4 to 5. 4, 5, 6, excuse me. Now, if you compare those values here, you will see that 1 is indeed less than 4. So it's true, and the result is true. If you compare those the other way around, you see that 4 is not lesser than 1, 5 is not lesser than 2, 6 is not lesser than 3, so the answer is false. So this is essentially a nice wrapper that allows you to write this code, I think, cleanly, but what is neat about it is it's actually using expression templates under the hood and CRTP. What this means is this evaluation is short-circuiting. So this is not just convenient and easy to type, this is also relatively efficient because determination happens as soon as the data is needed. So in this case, when you compare those two vectors and you see that 1 is lesser than 4, then entire evaluation bails out at this point because we already know that the answer is true. This gets propagated to the any expression template. The answer is returned immediately. So we do not traverse the entire vector in order to answer the question. As soon as we are able to encounter a value that gives us the result, we bail out. So this is very similar to what libraries like Eigen do or Armadillo for linear algebra, lazy evaluation expression templates. And we can also embed R on C++ side. Here is a simple example. It's from the built-in samples, actually. So we just have ordinary function int main. We then create an R environment or embedded R instance. Let's call this R. Then what I can do is to set a variables from that embedded R instance. For instance, I set a variable txt to contain hello world. And then I can parse the R commands from C++. For instance, I would like to just concatenate or show the value of my txt variable on the screen. And when I do that, indeed I can see hello world. So this integration is really two ways. You can call C++ from R, but you can also call R from C++. There's actually a pretty nice example that is using Qt and WT to have an interactive application that uses R for data analysis and has a GUI made in C++. And this is a showcase for the R insight. So what libraries can you use? Boost C++ header libraries for now. There's also Rcpp Armadillo, Rcpp Eigen, Rcpp GSL, Rcpp Parallel, which supports the thread building blocks from Intel. Yes? No, not that GSL. So it's no scientific library. It was a bit before that, but yeah. We have overloading names in C++. So as an example, for instance, there is a very useful class called Map in Eigen. that allows you to refer to the existing memory region. And to just to finish this presentation with how you can use those C++ libraries, well, the same way, suppose I would like to have make use of C++ codebase that depends on the eigen library. I try to source it. Notice that I'm trying to use some type from eigen. This is a fresh installation, so I don't have eigen library installed. So it will notify me that the package is not available. So I do the usual thing. I call install packages rcpp eigen, press enter, and then I can use eigen from my C++ codebase. So what we did actually is to plug in the C++ libraries to the R package manager. So the dependencies that include C++ libraries are also managed. And it's important, I think, as a user to know that it's not just one library or two libraries. There is a list of currently supported C++ libraries. Maybe I can go through this list. Shouldn't take too long. Just a few of them. I could just read it off. Well, there's a few C++ libraries that you can use right now with the package management. And I think this is important because then our users often don't know what's configure, they don't know what's make, they don't know what's the difference between apt-get in Ubuntu and nuget on Windows. They may not even know that those things exist, they just want things to work out the same way they work from R. So I think that plugging all of those C++ libraries to the R's package management is kind of convenient too. Here's when you can learn more. Again, I recommend Dirk's book. Here's when you can find help. There's a very active mailing list. There is also a community on Stack Overflow. You can also find more details about libraries. You can stay up to date with the blogs. There are several conferences. The slides will be made available. I know I only went through the subset, so I will, of course, upload them. All right. Thank you. Are there any questions? Yes. So the answer is it depends. So one of the things I've shown before was the OpenMP, for example. Let's see if I can find the code real quick. Close, and very close, there we go. So we see here, we have the serial version on top, and then we have parallel version in the bottom, right? And what we are doing is to traverse the numbers vector, and then we read each number, and then we sum this in parallel. So this is fine, and I think the closest analogy is when it's fine for std containers, it will be fine for rcpp container. So for instance, if you mentally replace the rcpp numeric vector in this code with std vector of double, and you are just reading the values, then it's fine. But there is no concurrency, there are no mutex protections like in Java that would wrap every single access to the vector, and you would be protected from the writes overlapping the same. Yeah, so you can read multiple values, and it's even if it's the memory region. It's the only problem is that if you would try to write, if you had a data race. So when you have multiple concurrent access, when at least one of them is a write and it is not synchronized, then just like in C++, you are going to have undefined behavior. But just as in C++, if all you do is read, then you are all right. Good question, thank you. Any more questions? All right, then, I would like to thank you for attending.